are we gonna die? I would still say probably not.
TriniGirlNatural.
Hi everyone, welcome to my channel. Let's get right to it. Are 80% of hair products toxic? Is ecostyler about to kill you? Well, it depends. Are you subscribed? Okay, just kidding. But yeah, let's get to this topic. You know, it's been going around recently that ecostyler has harmful ingredients and it's about to kill us all. And I'm here to bring you the facts. So if you're subscribed to my channel, you know that we have a lot of fun, but when information is needed, I'm here to the rescue to just give you the facts and bring some objectivity, sanity, and just the truth to you guys. So here I am to talk about ecostyler and just talk about black hair products and hair products in general and how safe they are and, you know, should you be alarmed, what you should do and stuff like that. That's what we're going to talk about right now. So fact number one, all the ecostylers contain triethanolamine. I'm just going to call it TEA for short. Heck, I'm just going to call it T for short, because it's that mouthful your mama warned you about in terms of like product ingredients and what you can pronounce and what you can't. This is a prime example of that. So I'm saying T. The official short is TEA, but I don't feel like saying TEA, so I'm just going to say T. Alright? Okay. So, yes, ecostyler does have it, and yes, I have ecostyler. As you guys, if you subscribe to my channel, you know that I use it occasionally. But we'll talk more about that later. Fact is, confession number one, I have one, and it has triethanolamine, T, in it. Right up in there. So that's out the way. So what is T? The official use for it in cosmetics, probably in ecostylers, as a pH balancer. Again, if you subscribe to my channel, I do believe that it's better to have per hair products in a particular pH range. Now, I haven't even tested ecostyler, so that could be a follow-up video. But basically, products don't want to be too alkaline or too acid for your hair. So they include things like pH balancers, and this happens to be one. So that's the official use, and that would be great if it wasn't for the side effects. What are the side effects? Let me let you know right now. T is an immune and respiratory toxicant or allergen. It's a skin toxicant, it's an organ toxicant. It's been known to cause cancer in mice. It hasn't been known directly to cause cancer in humans. That's the word, that's the official word from their sponsors, I should say, because of course, lobbyists and money has a lot to do with what ends up in your products and what ends up being used and so on. So that's the heavy, that's the hard, that's the scary, right? Now let's kind of rewind and put it in context and try to figure out what it means and should we be alarmed, etc., etc. Just because a chemical is known to be dangerous and bad doesn't necessarily mean that we have to run out screaming immediately or that we'll die if we use ecostyler once, because officially the amounts that you're allowed to put into products is limited. So you're not going to be allowed to put enough to kill you immediately, officially. And I say officially because the FDA really doesn't check every single product. So it is a lot of trust, guesswork, and so on. Some companies put a higher concentration of stuff in there, and they put stuff in there they don't report. So just because it's supposed to be safe doesn't necessarily mean it is. And even if they do put the right amount in there, the fact that people are still experiencing irritations and allergens and so on says that even at the so-called safe concentration, it's not going to be safe for everybody. There are people who are extremely sensitive that will still be affected even at that limit. If you say something like it wouldn't be on the shelves if it was dangerous, that's not actually true, because there are a lot of dangerous things that slip onto the shelf due to lack of funding and just lack of enforcement of regulation. Not to mention that the FDA is known for being very lax in terms of what chemicals they allow in products in the first place. We know that the European Union is a lot stricter, and a lot of things that they allow in the US is banned in Europe. And of course, when the FDA regulates something, I always think to myself and tell people, they regulate it for dime size use, basically. So they're not regulating it for people who are using a pound of it, wearing it all week as opposed to shampooing every day or every 2 days. So just the way that we wear products, using more product, leaving it on longer, elevates our risk above what is measured for. So let's say the line was here for standard hair type people. For us, the line is probably here. So there's probably that little delta of extra risk just because of the way we use product. Again, I'm not trying to be too nerdy on y'all, but let's just say because of how we use product, there's extra risk to us. Recently, there was a study, well, not even recently, it's been a couple years now, by the Silent Spring Institute that also highlighted some of these things that I'm talking about. They found that the prevalence of parabens and DEP and other toxins were consistently higher in the biomonitoring of Black women. So Black women actually literally have more toxins in their body than white women. And we also show more diseases and symptoms related to some of those toxins. You know, like early puberty could actually be due to our hair products, as well as the chicken and like the typical things that we talk about. This study mentioned that nearly 80% of the products targeting Black women actually contain numerous toxins that are harmful to the health. Based on the study, the products that are marketed towards us tend to have worse ingredients, higher levels of toxins than the kind of regular out there products. And it mentioned actually that 84% of the chemicals listed weren't even on the label. So we're freaking out about things on the label, and rightfully so. But there are chemicals that may not even be on the label. So that's something else to note. If you look for triethanolamine, you find it in a lot of hair products, as well as other toxins, parabens, the methylene and cloisol, thiazolamine. Those are found even in conditioners and just kind of all the hair products. And if you look at the study, I'll link it down below. They go into all the different ingredients that they tested for and so on. So it's kind of a separate topic, but it's really not, because again, ecostyler is a pretty typical product with respect to ingredients that you find kind of out there for hair, Black women, natural hair, in stores geared towards them, in stores targeting them and so on, and in the ethnic section, let's put it that way. So the study mentioning 80%, do I think the numbers that are high? No. I mean, this was in 2008, first of all, and there have been so many natural hair brands trying to be healthier since then. Of course, it's probably still 80% in the dollar store and in the low-end beauty supply stores and so on. And some of us actually shop in those places, so I still think we need to be concerned. Even if you may not be buying there, there's some sister buying there at that 80% level. So it's good to kind of be concerned and be aware of what's in our hair products and how they're affecting us. If you just wanna YOLO and just enjoy life when we all die sometime, I guess that's fine. I'm not saying that you have to just be a complete health freak. If that's what you wanna do with your life, fine. They may not make you sick tomorrow. They may not make you sick with 100% certainty, but they do increase your chance of becoming sick. Even if you're using these products every day, some will probably fall, but you might be fine. You personally might be fine. Other people might see a small, maybe a 1%, 5%, 10% increased chance of illness in their lifetime because of the products. So it's kind of up to you if you want to take that chance and how often you want to take that chance and just how much of a risk you're willing to add to your life. So for example, me, I mostly use healthy products in DIY, but I do have EcoStyler, knowing that it does have some bad, like some stuff in there that I don't need. I do use things like Tresemme and VO5 and like Xoxo conditioners, knowing that it has chemicals in there that I'd rather not use. Just kind of for lack of options with the conditioner, lack of cheap options with the conditioner. And I know for a lot of people they use this EcoStyler again because it's a cheap option. So balancing the finances with the health risk is important. I guess you know that old saying that it's expensive to try to be healthy, but it's even more expensive to be sick. Which people can just kind of throw out in. It's really hard to live by if you actually don't have money. But it's just something to keep in mind if you kind of maybe could be a little healthier, but you use it as an excuse then. If you're not using it as an excuse and you really don't have money, then if I didn't have money, I would DIY personally. But if you don't have money or time and you really want to have hair, I guess, and you don't want to just like chop it off, I guess, you know, you have to have that increased risk, but just be as aware as you can and try to limit your exposure as much as you can. So I do use cheaper conditioners, but I try to rinse them out as soon as possible. I do use EcoStyler and stuff like that, but I try to maybe use it once every 3 months or something. Like, I really don't use it a lot. If I'm somewhere where I don't have access to my flaxseed or Camuros, I might pick up one and just use it. Or even if I just feel for a change and it's like once every 3 months, I feel like I'm probably not gonna increase my risk of having a severe impact that much over my lifetime, hopefully. You know, but if you can just cut it out altogether, then that's definitely a good option as well. And it's up to you if you choose to reduce your risk and how you choose to reduce your risk. And like I said, the risk is really tiny for most of us. So, you know, think about it. We all know that when we get sick, even though we get cancers at a lower rate, we are actually more likely to die from it because, again, racism, basically. There's still medical textbooks in the United States that say blacks feel less pain. And it's still a statistical fact that blacks receive worse healthcare at every level. They receive less painkillers at every level. Like, they just don't care. So staying healthy becomes even more important. And I know we all fall short and stuff, but, you know, every day is a new day to try to be healthy. At least try to make a plan in terms of, okay, what do I think I can give up? What do I think I can do to try to be a little healthier? Because if you do get to the hospital with cancer or anything else, your chance of dying is a lot higher than a white person's chance of dying just because of how doctors relate to you. Sad statistical fact. And what can you do to avoid harmful ingredients or be aware of them? My main thing is just to research, like, every ingredient that I see that I don't recognize, I look it up. So EWG is a good source. Truth in Aging is a good source. The European Union actually has a website also that you can use. ECHA, the European Chemicals Agency. Because the FDA, like I said, is kind of, to me, more impacted by American lobbying and financial corruption, basically. And the European Union has tighter standards. So if you want to get an idea of what some people consider healthy, even though it might be allowed here, the ECHA website is also a good resource. So don't just say, oh, ecostyler is bad, go grab another gel, because you might be grabbing a gel that's just as bad. So you can't just follow the hype, you have to actually do your research. Become a researcher, like that's the only way to really go about it, because there are hundreds of toxins, there are thousands of chemicals, and the numbers just keep going up every day. So nobody can sit here and list everything for you. It's going to take hours, and then tomorrow there'll be a new one. So you just have to become a researcher. Do you know who is manufacturing the products that you're buying? Because they can be just throwing in cheap toxins in there and really not even care about your health. But you're standing for them like, oh, I'm going to buy it. And they don't even care about you. You know, just saying. Make sure that they have an honest track record. That's why Shea Moisture is still cancelled for me. Because you want to buy from ethical, honest companies. Also to increase your chance of staying safe. That's why Alkaline Naturals is also cancelled for me. Because their track record in terms of their response to safety issues isn't good. And once something is cancelled for me, I might be able to tell it stays cancelled at least for a good long while. So Shea Moisture cancelled, Alkaline cancelled. Shea Moisture just for lack of ethics and Alkaline for their handling of that whole lead scandal. Company honesty to me also includes labeling. If I see a label like cure all your split ends, grow your hair long in a month, and they have lots of labels like that. If I see a label with ridiculous claims, I just don't even buy it because again, I can't trust you. If I can't trust you as a company, I'm not buying. If there's a big picture of some exotic ingredient in the front, but it's down in the bottom of the ingredients list, like anything after fragrance, unless it's like essential oils, is a throwaway. So if the fancy ingredient occurs after fragrance, not even buying, don't trust them. If a product has mostly natural ingredients, then I'm more likely to trust them, especially if the natural ingredients are higher up on the list. And of course, those companies tend to charge a bit more, but I'm able to afford them and invest in them. If I wasn't, I personally would DIY. For me, DIY isn't hard because I DIY once every 2 months probably, and I just put it in the freezer and it stays there safe and happy until I'm ready to use it. So it's not like if I have to do it every week or anything, but I know some people don't even have 1 day a month to make conditioner and gel and stuff. If you don't have the DIY option either, then, you know, try to still be aware of ingredients and pick the lesser of the evils if you have to choose between products. That's why we have small businesses, like a lot of the ones I review on my channel, that try to contain the safest preservatives and the safest ingredients and still have your hair healthy. So that's definitely an option if you're concerned. It's up to you to kind of be in charge of your health and in charge of your life as opposed to just letting things happen, just more taking charge of it. So that was it. Summary takeaway, ecostyler does contain a toxin. The concentration is supposed to be safe. It does affect some people even though the concentration is supposed to be safe. And we probably use more and use it for longer. than the typical use, so the numbers that are safe for them may not be safe for us. But there's still only a slight increased chance of becoming sick, but there is an increased chance of becoming sick. That little possibility is there, so it just depends on how concerned you are, how safe you want to be and stuff like that. And you should be aware of which ingredients are bad, which ingredients are good, at least in the things that you use. So that's it. I hope I was helpful. I hope I shed some light and broke it down for you guys. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.